Hi, everyone. I'm Greg Fox with West 2 News and West.com, and this is a debate in the Florida Senate District 15 race. District 15 covers a large part of West Orange County, from Apopka to Winter Garden, parts of Orlando, Pine Castle, and the Dr. Phillips area. The candidates in this race are Geraldine Thompson and Kamia Brown, and both currently serve as state representatives in Metro Orlando. Thank you very much for your commitment to serve.
Thank you for having me.
This is important here, even though both are Democrats. This is an open primary race. And since no Republican or independent qualified, all the voters in Senate District 15 will see this race on their ballots in that district, and the winner, August 23rd, will be going to the state Senate. First, I'll give each of you 1 minute to tell us about your experience. Since you're both state representatives, that should be easy, and to tell us a little bit about why you think you can serve in the Senate chamber. And we'll start with Ms. Thompson.
Thank you very much, and thank you for the invitation to be here. I represent House District 44, and that includes West Orange County, Windermere, Winter Garden, portions of Ocoee. And this is a district, in terms of the Senate district, that I've served before. Very little has changed with regard to the Senate district. I served in the Senate from 2012 until 2016. So I'm a known quantity with regard to the constituents who live in the district. And one of the things that I did in 2020 after COVID, I spent a lot of time, and my staff members spent a lot of time getting unemployment assistance and compensation for people who found themselves unemployed through no fault of their own. The major employer in my area, as in Central Florida, is Walt Disney World, which furloughed 77,000 people. So you can just imagine the overwhelming demand to say, help us through this. So I'm a person who I really focus on constituent services. Many times you may not get legislation passed, but what the job is all about is working with citizens and helping them navigate through the state process.
All right, we'll talk more about that. That was more than a minute. I'm gonna give you a minute and a half to 2 minutes to tell us about yourself, Ms. Brown. Go ahead.
Well, thank you, Greg. Thank you for having me here. Again, as you mentioned, I'm Kamia. I'm a mom, I am a daughter, a sister, and a friend who has had the opportunity to be blessed to live a life of public service. I've got started in the Florida legislature as an intern, and then from there, 14 years working around the state, working in constituent services as a legislative aide. I then asked the constituents of District 45 to elect me so that I can have a deeper commitment of really advocating for the critical issues that affected my community. We wanted a place that you can live, work, and raise a family. I've been serving in the House for 3 terms now, have passed meaningful legislation, have been able to be a part of my district, and looking to, again, take that next step of continuing my service, because my work is not done, looking to do that service as a senator for District 15.
All right, so this is an interesting race because we have two candidates that have a track record, have service, have been to Tallahassee, know what the look and feel of that is like. So now's the important part, trying to find out the differences so voters can make a decision. Can you tell me, first of all, and we'll continue with you, Ms. Brown, what is the first bill you would file and explain why that is?
Well, I would look to continue my service. I've spent a lot of time working on healthcare. Healthcare access and health disparities have really been a critical issue within not only my community, but throughout our state. And so we've been doing work. This past year, we were able to put money in the budget to look at a study relating to sickle cell. You have 100,000 constituents or throughout the state of Florida that are that have this disease. And so looking to work, that would be one of the bills I would pass, one bill that I would work in the legislature of making sure we are able to provide access to medicine that could possibly cure the sickle cell disease for many of the patients that suffer through it.
All right, Ms. Thompson, first bill you'll file and why?
I've been working on a draft of the Tyree Sampson law to deal with amusement parks and making sure that they are appropriately scrutinized. As I said, I served District 44, which includes I drive. It includes all of the theme parks. And we know that a 14-year-old child visiting from St. Louis for the spring break fell from a ride over 400 feet in the air and died here in Orlando. And so I would want to make sure that the rides are appropriately inspected, that before we issue a permit, that we look at safety records for the operators of the rides. This is not a partisan issue. Most people who come to Orlando enjoy our amenities without exception. However, this is a very serious exception, and we don't want exceptions. And so I would be looking at training, looking at, as I said, a longitudinal record in terms of safety, so that people, when they come to Orlando, feel safe and that they know that state legislators have looked at every way that they can in terms of whether it's signage or weight requirements, height requirements, to make sure that their life and their safety is safeguarded here in Orlando. That would be my very first bill.
And I want to continue on this just for a second, and I'd like you to weigh in, Ms. Brown. Obviously, the investigation is not over. The Department of Agriculture is continuing to investigate this tragic fall from this ride. But have you sensed that there's some deficiencies in either inspections, the way they look after rides and safety? We are, after all, the theme park capital of the world.
Well, I think it's important that we allow the investigation to continue. You know, all Floridians deserve the right to be freedom, to have the freedom to be safe, to also be healthy and prosperous. And, you know, this was just such an important, I'm sorry, not important, but a very unfortunate issue that happened right in our backyard. And I just look forward to what the various investigations bring out and how we together as a community and as a state fix the necessary issues to make sure when visitors come here, they don't have to worry.
All right, very good. Let's move on to affordable housing. Rent went up 25% last year in Orange County and now average $1,800 a month. A lot of working families that are not making the kind of money that would allow that to be able for them to have their families live there. So, Ms. Thompson, first of all, what do we do about this from the state legislative level to try to help with affordable housing? At least in this budget, we saw the Sadowski funding fully funded this year.
Well, I think there are a number of ways to approach it, and we need to make sure that the Sadowski Fund dollars are used for affordable housing rather than being swept into general revenue and used for other projects. In addition, I think we need to help developers see that it's profitable to build affordable housing, and perhaps that means incentives, tax breaks or whatever, because a lot of the developers find it more attractive to build high-end rather than to build affordable housing. I think as well we need to look at building up rather than building out. We have a lot of sprawl here in Central Florida, and I think building up will mean that we get greater return on the investment, and we have multifamily units that people can afford to rent or to own. And then we've got to look at inflation. I think that's a big problem in terms of the scarcity of housing, and which means then that the housing units that are available go for much higher rates. And so the Sadowski funds, incentive for development, building up, those are some of the ways I would approach affordable housing.
Ms. Brown, how about the affordable housing? And, you know, in Orange County, there's been this discussion lately. They did a study, is capping rents or capping the increase annually in rent. Any of those ideas, or what's your plan to help out with the affordable housing?
Well, as Senator Thompson mentioned, I think it's important for us to, you know, make sure, you know, we have all opportunities available. And she mentioned a great point of incentivizing our developers. I think we have seen where things work so well with public-private partnerships. And we've seen where many of our community stakeholders are now also doing their part to do what they can in relation to affordable housing. When you hear of Disney, when you hear of Universal. And I think it's more of those partnerships that will be able to help us to deal with part of the problem. I think what Tallahassee has to do is pass legislation that will not allow us to play flip-flop of whether or not we will fully fund this year, but we will be required to fully fund every year. That bill has been surfacing around the legislature, and each year it has been getting more and more bipartisan support. And I think it's important for us to really look at that, because it's our job as state lawmakers to make sure constituents and also the businesses and folks that we attract to want to be here, we have to do our part to make sure to provide the support that they need to do their job.
Let's stick with Ms. Brown for a second here. So part of the equation here is mm-hmm. getting those wages boosted up. We have 15% of people in Orange County that are below the poverty level. And obviously, we're raising our minimum wage gradually up to $15 an hour by 2026. But there's people right now that they need help. What can be done, or what is your plan to bring more economic growth that isn't theme park or amusement related into Orange County?
Well, I think the big, huge rave now that folks are really looking into is becoming a business owner, becoming an entrepreneur. As we know, many of the jobs here in the area are sort of stuck or at a cap. We are a service industry. And so what you see now is a lot of entrepreneurs or new entrepreneurs coming into the business of working for themselves and finding, you know, the additional revenue they need to take care of their family. I think there has to be more support from the state. Me and the legislature, I've been a big small business advocate, and I think, you know, when you're looking at programs that's with the Department of Economic Opportunity, it needs to provide opportunity for all businesses. A lot of times, especially with African-American businesses, there is opportunity to thrive, but only laterally. Mm-hmm. I think we need to make sure that all of these businesses or these small businesses that are coming, because this state is full of mom and pop businesses, we need to make sure everyone have the tools so that they're able to scale up versus just sideways and just succeeding. A lot of folks want to leave legacy.
Ms. Thompson, so continuing on this, we've got a median income of Orange County for a family of four of $63,000 a year, but I think we all know here that that's mostly brought up by a lot of high earners. Mm-hmm. There's an awful lot of families that are out there struggling. What is your plan to either diversify the economy in Orange County and maybe get away from that service industry model that we've had for the last half century?
Well, we need to look at manufacturing. We had an opportunity to bring a major business here to manufacture lasers. And one of the things that you need to manufacture lasers is sand. Florida has lots of sand. So we need to be looking at opportunities to diversify, and manufacturing is one of the ways that we do that. I believe that businesses are now seeing the wisdom of paying $15 an hour, because there is a labor shortage. And I took the challenge from SEIU years ago to live on minimum wage for a week. And I did okay until my gas light went on, and then I took public transportation. So I knew firsthand the challenges that people face when they don't make a livable wage. Even going to the grocery store, you make choices based on the price rather than based on the nutrient value of the food that you're selecting. So looking at other things in addition to tourism is what I think we need to be doing.
Go ahead.
And also, I think it's important that we look at innovation. I mean, we are a hub of innovation and technology, and we have the tools right here in our backyard to do that. So it's important that we create the pipeline for a workforce that is able to, you know, be able to go to those high wage jobs. We have children who are deciding whether or not they're going to go into the workforce, or whether or not they are going to continue their education, post-secondary education. And I think it's important that we focus more so on our education or the tools to give the folks what they need in order to make those choices to utilize our resources that we currently have, but also be successful in that as well.
All right, Ms. Brown, 45 seconds to wrap up this discussion and we'll move on.
I think apprenticeships are very important. I've been supporting apprenticeships for a long time. And one of the groups that does that very well is the electrical workers. They bring young people in, teach them the skills that they need, and place them with employers. And many times this leads to full-time jobs at very high wages. And so I think apprenticeship is another way to get us where we need to be in terms of getting to the $15 an hour.
All right, we'll stay with Ms. Thompson. Let's change gears here a little bit. We've seen in the past year, we've seen laws passed by a Republican-run legislature and our Republican governor, the Woke Act, which made limit diversity training in the workplace, parental rights in education bill, which has gotten a lot of headlines and taken a lot of our news time, too, in debate. The fact is, you're both Democrats, okay? One of you is going to be the next senator in District 15. Assuming that the legislature remains in Republican control, what do you want to tell voters about your ability to work across the aisle to get across what you want to get across and pass bills that you want to pass?
Well, one of the things that I did when we had a bill coming through the House dealing with teaching the Holocaust, the history of the Holocaust, was to work with the Republican sponsor to get an amendment on the bill that required teaching of the Ocoee massacre as well. So I am not wedded to working only with Democrats. I'm wedded to working with anybody who can get us the results. And when you think about the young man who drove to Buffalo and killed all of those people at the supermarket, he didn't learn to devalue African-American lives in the classroom. He learned it in society. We've got to deal with it, and I think the classroom is where you deal with it. The classroom is the solution rather than the problem. And when we talk about critical race theory, which has not been taught in K-12, it's a graduate level course normally taught in law school, we can't whitewash history and stick our heads in the sand and pretend that factual occurrences did not happen in the United States. And I think we get to a point where we understand each other better, we value each other better, if we know each other better, which means making sure that the classroom and what we teach reflects the diversity of our population.
Mm-hmm. Before I go to Ms. Brown, are we in a culture war right now?
Oh, absolutely. We're in a culture war, and we spend a lot of time in Tallahassee talking about CRT. We hear all the time about the great replacement theory, which is what motivated the shooter in Buffalo, the idea that Black people, other people are trying to replace white people. You saw that in Charlottesville when there were chants about Jews not replacing the white population. And so I think to get us beyond the culture wars, you can't do that if you won't communicate. So we've got to come together and we've got to communicate.
All right, that's a lot to unpack there. A couple of bills, culture wars. Go ahead, I'll give you 2.5 minutes there.
Okay, thank you. Well, I think what we have in Tallahassee is the governor continuing to use the politics of distraction. Well, he continues to, again, race bait. He continues to attack Black, not only with the anti-woke, not only with the Don't Say Gay bill, but you also look at what he's done with just silencing Black voters. What we have seen with the redistricting issue. You know, how is it that we have additional, we have what, over $2 million, I mean, not over $2 million, but over 2 million additional minorities that have come to the state of Florida, but somehow we don't have additional minority representation seats, but instead we have a reduction, a 50% reduction of minority representation seats. Mm-hmm. That's a problem, and it is something that continues to happen. One thing I have not allowed Tallahassee to do is to distract me from the needs that I need for my constituency. We have heard about the Black maternal mortality crisis and just the continuous lack of resources there are for our pregnant moms. We saw it right in COVID. As a mom to a toddler, I saw it firsthand. I was able to bipartisanly pass legislation that no one thought I ever could do. I've talked to many news reporters on what were those bills that I was passed. Many said that that could never be done with extending postpartum Medicaid benefits to moms from 6 weeks to now a whole year. Our folks, Democrats, many of our businesses have been screaming for the need for us to pass Medicaid expansion. And so this was a way to do that. Not only was I able to do that for our postpartum mom, but also our foster care children. We know the resources that are needed when it comes to mental health or behavioral health from just the displacement of being away from home. I know firsthand of just having relatives that had to go live with grandparents or cousins, but still was unhappy because they were away from mom. Those are things that I have championed. Additional resources for our juvenile justice, or our juveniles, for our families to really provide. We had an issue right in Ocoee back in 2016, 2017 when I sponsored the bill, but it dealt with a woman who, again, loved her family, worked at Lockheed Martin, but was murdered by her child. Mm-hmm. Continued to go to law enforcement, but was unable to get the resources she needed to help bring a stronger family together. We were able to pass a bill that provided those resources that now families need to bring them together.
We certainly have been shocked by just the number of mass shootings that have gone on in our country in the past 4 to 6 weeks. Back in 2018, the Parkland bill after the Marjorie Stoneman Douglas massacre in South Florida was passed. It created a red flag law that at last check, more than 8,000 times has been used to remove firearms from someone deemed to be a threat to themselves, deemed to be a threat to others. And in addition, it raised the age to buy a long gun from 18 to 21. Now, you are all very familiar with this. My question, we'll start with you, Ms. Brown, is if you go back to the legislature, what needs to come next in your view, if anything, in gun control?
There definitely has to be more done within gun control. The legislature, we need to ban assault rifle weapons. I think that it is very important. When you see the various tragedies that are happening around our country and at our schools and even in our own backyard, many of those students or people have come in to use assault rifles. And I think it's important that we really look at what we are doing, and not only collectively as a legislature, but also as a community. A lot of times the voice or the vote is what gets people to Tallahassee to vote and to represent you and your interests. And again, at what point are we gonna put our children first, our families first? You know, the things that we love to do, you know, they're now at risk. Going to the grocery store, going to a church. I think it's important that we not only as lawmakers do something, but also stand together as a community to make sure those we send to Tallahassee know that this has to be a priority and done.
So, because I'm gonna ask this of Ms. Thompson too, again, If you're going to go that route, assault weapons, large magazines, again, how do you do that, or do you take smaller steps to try to work with Republicans who may oppose this?
Absolutely. I think what I have learned in the process is knowing that, you know, you can't have the whole apple. It takes, you know, many times 6 to 8 to 10 years to get legislation actually passed. But it takes, again, being in a Republican-controlled legislature, it takes both sides to really pay attention to these issues. We've done it when you look at the area of early education. It took, there are Democrats that are continuously talking about making sure we invest in our children, but it's a universal issue. And I think it's important that if you work groups within the legislature with your colleagues, it's important that we make sure we, you know, talk to them and, you know, little by little, take a bite at the apple and solve this issue.
All right, Ms. Thompson, that's kind of a combination double question there. Okay, do you take a next step in gun control? If so, in your view, what is that, or what would you file on a bill? And then again, how do you get that across if the legislature remains under Republican control?
Well, I think there are some allies that we need to stand shoulder to shoulder with. And I think law enforcement are our allies. You're asking law enforcement officers to go into situations where a person has a military type assault weapon with ammunition with enough rounds to kill hundreds of people. And so their lives are in jeopardy, their lives are imperiled. And so I think we need to bring along people who would be allies to us when we say that it is very dangerous. And it's not for a civilian person to defend themselves. You don't need a military type assault weapon. The reason the military type assault weapons is the weapon of choice for mass shooters, you don't have to be a marksman. You don't have to have good aim. You just point in the general direction and you have enough bullets, you have the long guns, and it just pulverizes people. So I think we need to involve our allies in this whole fight for the safety of our communities. And Representative Brown talked about maternal child health and extending Medicaid coverage. That was a priority of the Speaker of the House, Representative Sprouse, and he made it known at the very beginning of the session that this was one of his top asks, and she was on the committee, yes, that was responsible for ushering it through. But I think because you had the support and you had the leadership of Chris Sprouse, it's how that bill got passed.
All right, I'll give you 45 seconds to respond because she mentioned your name. Go ahead.
Thank you. And I think a lot of times those types of things happen in the legislature where, but typically they happen when it comes to Republican members, where they tend to provide, you know, certain bills of priority. In this case, it did not happen that way. It was a bill that before he gave out his priority, I had already had the bill filed. Not only was this work that I had been doing that year, I've been working within the healthcare and health disparity space for quite some time. Not only with, and it was him, Speaker Sprouse, who came to me. I didn't go to him. He came to me, but he was told by many of our colleagues, including one here locally, that was an issue that I've always championed. And it was something that I had already been working on. And that's been a lot of things that I've done, is I don't need anyone to give me a bill. I've been able to pass them and think of those on my own.
All right, so this is gonna be the wrap-up question, then we'll have closing statements. We'll stick with you, Ms. Brown. Again, the most important part of this debate is to find out how you are not like her and you are not like her. So I'm gonna give you 1 minute each. Go ahead, how are you most different from Ms. Thompson?
I think just with the current political climate in Tallahassee, just in my short time of being able to push a button, I've had the opportunity to not only speak up, speak out, but also pass legislation. I've been very effective in Tallahassee each year that I have been, whether it's been passing bills or attaching bills. I had the opportunity just, you know, through my time there to learn the process and know that there was more than one way to skin a cat. I am in the community. This is a community that I was born and raised in, and it would be an honor for me to, again, support the village that supported me, that got me to where I was. I brought millions of appropriations to many of the communities I serve. I not only serve parts of Orange County, but I serve other cities as well. And in this climate, it's important to, again, not only speak up, stand up, but you gotta be able to bring things home. And I've been able to do that very well. And it's been noticed not only by my Democratic colleagues, but also the others as well, including many of the senators who are supporting this race.
All right, Ms. Thompson, that was closer to 2 minutes. Go ahead. How are you most different from Kamia Brown?
I take on the tough challenges, whether it means filing a lawsuit to protect the independence of the judiciary, whether it's about claims bills that for a while have been languishing. I was able to get $1.2 million for James Joseph Richardson, who had been on death row and wrongfully incarcerated in Florida for over 22 years. The same thing applied for a young boy named Daniel Decembre, which meant $1 million to help him after he was disfigured, after he was attacked by a pit bull who ran into the schoolyard here in Orlando. But when people cast a vote by mail, that was my bill, Senate Bill 112, which eliminated the absentee ballot procedure where you had to show cause, but it made vote by mail ballots available to everyone, every voter in the state of Florida. So I've passed meaningful legislations and taken on the tough challenges, whether that meant not allowing a Confederate statue of Edmund Kirby Smith to come to Lake County, whether that meant that we were looking at our community and asking for change. When Pulse Nightclub was in my district, I talked to Governor Scott, you know, this is years ago, and talked about the need for universal background checks, talked about the large magazines of bullets, talked about the AR-15. So I've been willing to step out and to take on the tough things, not just, you know, to be there and play nice with everyone, but to take on the things that needed to be taken on.
All right, very good. We're going to conclude now. You each have 1 minute. We'll begin with Ms. Thompson.
Thank you very much. I have appreciated the opportunity to be here. I am excited about the opportunity to serve a community that I served for 4 years in the state Senate. Not a lot of change has happened, even with the new redistricting. So these are individuals that I have worked with who know me. Many of them still come to me. I was able to get a portion of Silver Star Road designated as the Julius July Perry Memorial Highway. He was killed in 1920 because he wanted to vote. He was lynched here. And the community came to me, even though that was not my district, that was Representative Brown's district, and asked me if I would shepherd that through, and I was able to get that done. So I look forward to continuing to work with the constituents of Senate District 15 to deal with the Tyree Sampson law and many other things that need great attention.
All right, Ms. Brown, please conclude.
Thank you, and thank you for the opportunity to be here and to actually hear both of our platforms and vision for this district. I know there was a comment made just recently relating to the July Perry Road. They actually came to me first, but again, I've always admired you, Senator Thompson, and your continuous work, especially with admiring, with acknowledging our history and making sure it's important. You've been a big champion in education. And so when they came to me, again, I knew that, you know, you would be a person, a great person to actually file that bill. But they did come to me. But we thank you for that. It was one that I did support and co-sponsor, and happy to see that we are acknowledging the wrongs that are happening within our backyard. Look, I have worked my way throughout this process, and it'd be an honor to serve a community that has raised me and has prepared me to do the things that I have been able to do in Tallahassee. I have been one who's been effective. And again, you know, knowing the needs of my district, I have always put those at the forefront of my service to this area. I love what I do, and I love doing it for the city that I love.
All right. Thank you both, Geraldine Thompson, Kamia Brown, both state representatives. This has been a WESH 2 News and WESH.com debate in the open primary for Florida District 15 Senate in Orange County. The winner, August 23rd, will be headed to the Senate in Tallahassee. And we thank all of you for watching.